So Erwin is works more than 50 years in different positions at AIT. Since his 2010, he retired and still very active, more active than ever, I think. And he's still working as a freelancer under various subcontracting in European research projects for AIT and other organizations. He's focusing his engagement was always on trustworthiness of highly reliable safety critical systems. So dependability, safety, cybersecurity, main topics here. And very active in industry projects and research projects, and in the standardization committee of ISO 615-08, also ISO 26262, and even in the beginning and up to now, and so still a very active as a standardization manager in several European Union projects. And so we're very interested in his talk today to give him more insights about ethics and social concerns about the hype of AI, how it's now ongoing in the several working groups here. And I think Erwin, will hand over to you, and we're very happy that you're a speaker of our meeting today.
Okay. Now I talk about high noon standardization. I mean, as it is written here, I really mean it, because everyone and everybody now thinks about AI. In any of the domain standards I know, at some time people started to work to create a subgroup who works on artificial intelligence usage in their domain. It is that absolutely independent which domain we mean, it's in all of them. Now, here's an overview. We have one generic AI standardization group, that's ISO IEC GTC1, Joint Technical Committee 1, Subcommittee 42. You see the high number because it's the youngest subcommittee in this Joint Technical Committee, because it started only a few years ago. But in this very short time, they did a lot of work with incredibly large number of, let's say, subgroups. For instance, they have 17 published standards already and 24 under development. And I have grouped these standards for my reports and other purposes into the foundational concepts and use cases, trustworthiness, decision-making, including bias and robustness, machine learning, software quality testing and validation verification, and something about ethical aspects, governance, and Green Deal. Also, there are even some environmental considerations on the energy consumption and so on, which is required because of the increasing use of AI. That is always, it's like the security issues in this security new methods that we need a lot of more of an energy. One has in the meantime calculated at the United Nations that if all vehicles of the world are autonomous, using all of the software and controls in electronic manner, they would need more electric energy than the whole world production is now. Also just for the vehicles. So you can imagine that, and therefore there's even standards arising on these environmental issues. Okay, with working groups, testing of AI-based systems is a joint working group, because the same topic was claimed by the software and systems engineering subcommittee 7. So they have a joint cooperation because the subcommittee 7 started already with the testing of AI-based systems. They mainly use this black box and gray box approaches. You mentioned some of the methods before in your presentation. Then, of course, health informatics. At the moment, in health informatics, artificial intelligence methods are not allowed concerning automatic operations or something, but of course, a supporting. Supporting means for doctors, but the last decision is, of course, with the medical doctors. But anyway, a lot of decisions are now taken by support of this AI-supported health informatics. And therefore, they have started with a working group in the meantime with between IEC and ISO on an AI-enabled health informatics. Then we have this working group one was the first one for digital standards. I remember that 4 years ago, when we just had an automotive presentation in this functional safety community, I mentioned the first time how this foundational standard for AI in the standard looks like, all these models from the data net to the effects outputs. Then we have a working group on big data. This will I not discuss here or mention any longer. It is about big data, data analytics, et cetera, which is very important in many respects, but it's not touched here. The working group three, I am a member of this working group on trustworthiness, the deal with robustness, bias, explainability, controllability, with the square ethics and sustainable. The square soft is the software quality issue of AI systems. That we have use cases applications, that was my question before, yeah, because they are really restrict almost in many cases now to automotive, because in automotive you have everything. You have the vision problems. We mentioned these examples where you can deceive AI system by just changing one pixel. Yeah, there are some examples like that. And that is a cybersecurity issue as well, because if someone knows how a certain image processing system works, for instance, in a particular type of vehicle, yeah, like a BMW or so of a certain type, then they can, of course, just make a very small attack and disable useful use of the vision systems. Then we have working group five, computational approaches. So AI is not only neural networks, it includes also the tools for machine learning, and it includes also directly computational approaches without neural networks, and they want to handle that in working group five. That's the latest working group in this. Then we have additionally standardization in other committees like in ETSI and in Zenzenelik. I will not refer to Zenzenelik because most of the work is a copy of ISO IEC work. But as I mentioned before, this some of these environmental issues and the nature, particularly natural language processing, are not done at the moment in ISO, but in the joint working group with Zenzenelik. And ETSI has also 9 published standards and 7 under development. So there's a lot. I've made listed here. I will not talk about them in detail. That's impossible. Yeah, in a reasonable time, each one of them could make an hour's presentation. Need about an 1 hour presentation. But at least we have a list which standards are published and now under development. And if you are interested in a certain topic here, you can look and join your national committee or so and ask for the to become member or so, then you get all the working documents. You will not get published standards because normally you should pay for them. So even I, although I work very often in these committees, can only keep the FDs, the last final draft of the standard, which is almost identical, of course, with the final standard. But this I can copy and save because it's deleted from the working spaces also from ISO and IEC. But anyway, even I would have to pay for the final standard. That is an unfriendly issue, but in ETSI it's better. ETSI standards can download everyone free from the internet. So the ETSI, the technical specifications are free for everyone. That's very important. What you here see are guide process management framework for big data analytics, one of the guidelines for AI applications. Yeah, they have a separate system lifecycle process, which deviates somehow by the construction, because you have many iterative processes in the machine learning and revision processes normally, and that is say covered in this AI system lifecycle process. I cannot discuss this in detail, but there is some. And then of course you have a management and you have concepts and terminology. Then in trustworthiness, that's a group where I am mostly we have this ISO IEC technical report 5469, functional safety. That is a very important one and needed the cooperation between the functional safety community in IEC, that's the standard 65008, which is a basic functional safety standard for all other reference standards on functional safety in domains, for instance, 2623. But the basis is always this 6508, which was mentioned, where I was already in the first edition active, as was mentioned in the introduction. Then you have the bias problem. Yeah, for this and in the decision make, which is a basic problem in all of this, and it's very dependent on the data you use as input and if the quality of the checks of the output in the machine learning process. Then you have overview of trustworthiness in artificial intelligence, an overview of all the properties and attributes which you could look at and which may be relevant, but that differs, of course, from application to application. The robust of neural networks is a very important part. It's a rather high level, as it does not discuss, as was done in the first presentation, some details and methods, but it gives a good overview of what you should look at. Yeah, but it does not, let's say, give references to methods you shall use or so, as it's done in IEC 65008, which have very strong recommendations. These standards are not prescriptive, but let's say qualitatively. Then you have guidance risk management issues. That is very important in any of these critical applications like automotive. The standard on treatment of unwanted bias, yeah, and the controllability of automated artificial intelligence, which is very important in industry and all these applications where automated decisions are the normally. Then you have machine learning standards on data quality for analytics and so on, with different subparts, how to measure quality and what is quality and what is the governance. That means your social responsibility when providing data and so on. So that it should not happen, for instance, that the Austrian Unemployment Service decided the automated system, okay, women after 50, you should throw out of the list that is not of any use, because it learned it from set of data and did not look into details if the individual person, for instance, has some qualification which is not so usual, as it was not even looked at because of this decision algorithms. And that was in all of the papers in Austria, this story. Yeah. Then you have the framework, of course, that was the initial work of the working group one, yeah, and of course the data lifecycle framework. Then a very important issue is this so-called explainability, and even the European Commission reviewed the standard proposals of TS6254, on explainability. This is the report, a specification which is worked on at the moment, and even gave a comment, yeah, and said in the AI Act, explainability is not a concept to be used in the AI Act proposal. The AI Act establishes an obligation to design the ISO in such a way that those persons who use an ISO are enabled to interpret its outputs. That means humans should be able to interpret the output, but it is not possible or necessary that how this output was derived by a neural network or so. And that clearly say that is interpretability. The concept of interpretability enables an appropriate level of transparency, what the human reader and user needs, and an effective human oversight. That's a particular topic in the AI standards. But without imposing requirements on explainability that may be unfeasible for certain types of AI systems. So anybody who has to do with AI systems knows that you cannot make a strict analysis of neural network systems. Yeah? That is the problem. And therefore, you should not make requirements, yeah, which are not feasible in practice. And even the European Commission told this to ISO in this one standard and to the Zenzendelec group. You see, they know very well what is possible and what not. Then you have quality testing, validation, verification. It was mentioned before as well as one of the most important parts, because you cannot use the regular classical methods. They are not sufficient in this case. And here are several standards under development and specifications covering this, and some even with these systems and software engineering groups together, because they cover, of course, the systems and software quality requirements, because these people do not care if it's AI or not. They say it must be valid for any software, yeah, what they have as requirements. So therefore, have now to create a joint working group on that. Very interesting to read. And then, of course, not to forget the ethical aspects and governance. Governance means the use by organizations, let's say companies, like, let's say, of public services and so on. Yeah. And of course, ethical aspects of autonomous machines. That's very important. And even the Green Deal, as I mentioned already in my question before, yeah. Environmental sustainability will become NTR as well after Zenzelec has started already some work on that too. Also there are many of these standards will become Zenzelec reports and standards as well. Also not everything is copied, fortunately, yes. Okay, now about ETSI. Now you see a lot of published ETSI standards. That means the threat ontology. So what are the threats to AI systems? Yeah, that's data you have to look at, even the supply chain, because data may not come only from a single source. Normally they come over several different tiers of supplies, yeah? Like in automotive production, even the data you have transferred are of course from all of these different levels. And of course you need the role of hardware is covered as well. And this is becoming important now in some subgroup between ISO and 26262 and E6508 on complex hardware safety. And this, for instance, has to consider in the end AI and secure AI as well. As you, they have even written some technical specification how to secure AI and on privacy aspects as well. Yeah? So these are already published and you can download them from the internet. Yeah? Then exists the issue of explainability and the transparency comes up again, and the traceability of the models, as how the models really work and how to understand these. Also there's a lot of side effects as well with on privacy and manipulation of multimedia identity representation. So see, there are a lot of subtopics covered here which are under development. Here's a short example how this approach is done in the group for secure AI, yeah, the report number 4 I used here. Yeah, they took the typical machine learning life cycle. You have the model design and the data acquisition and the data curation, so to check them for validity. Then you implement it in circles between build, train, and test, and to make a deployment. And even then you have to check against the reality, data acquisition, data curation, and the results leads to updates. These are all cycles. So there are some provisions in this document what to think about. And they're looking primarily here on this machine learning life cycle, where of course security plays a role as well, also during the so-called production process. The second is, how you could attack if you know the algorithms and how, for instance, image, let's say, evaluated, I said it before, yeah? And this is a second way to look at the security issues. If you look at this DS-58-3 on autonomous, it's called de facto automated driving systems, yeah, in general. They have a lot of, let's say, cyber attacks, connection points for attacks, and in all of these today are AI modules, and how to analyze even the properties of a system which is operating, and to detect malicious, let's say, attacks is and behavior is as well as an eye issue. Yeah, so these are people thinking on. In this ETSI report, they have for each life cycle phases from data acquisition to the deployment and upgrade cycle, they identified some issues, where are the major issues, integrity, generic issues in model decided software build, confidential integrity issues in the training, of course, the bias and so on. And below, I've written some of the design challenges and even the unintentional factors. You always could have some subjective data and make an unintended bias, for instance. Yeah? That the explainability issue, where the commission says it's enough to have this interpretability issue resolved and not only the explainability, because it cannot be proven in many cases what's correct. Then there are the ethics issues. That means there are ethics guidelines how systems should behave. For instance, the German Commission for Automated and Connected Driving has set up 20 principles, such like there should be a preference for vulnerable road users. You should protect the first and the vulnerable road users. These are then persons and cyclists and so on. That's also to take care particularly on them. And second, you should not, let's say, differentiate between the type of people, for instance. You have very often these undecidable situations you can break, but it will not work because the distance properly, because the distance is too small. And then, of course, you could decide to overrun the left or the right person and so on. Also, there is not allowed to have any of these decisions in your systems, even implicit. Yeah. Also, that is a very important ethical aspect. I have once already talked about these ethical issues in more detail. Then the attack awareness and misuse is important. That means the designers, developers, and the users must be aware of this. And of course, this, misuse means that you are not really attacking it, but you use a feature in a manner that was not intended to be for good, so to say. So this is, for instance, one of another issue. Okay. I will talk a little bit about this very important functional safety and AI systems technical report 5469. I have been in this group from the very beginning. I could not take part in all of the recent ones meetings because it's very advanced already at the moment. But the pictures I have here are taken from the DTR, which is under the final stage now, that had been voted upon, it was accepted by the national committees, and now with the final, the comments are introduced and let's say evaluated. They could only make a report because they could not set up a mandatory requirements, because that is at the moment from the maturity of these technologies and the knowledge about it, not possible. That was a decision at the beginning. Therefore, we said, okay, we can classify technology classes of AI with class one. It can be developed and reviewed, maybe even a black box review, existing functional safety method, then that's class one. Class two is that cannot be fully developed, reviewed to the functional safety method standards, as for instance in 26262 or IEC 61508, but it is possible to identify a set of available methods, setting for the properties or have workarounds or envelopes, etc. And class three is assigned if that is not possible in any case, and you have no available methods and tactics to certify the required functional safety properties. Then you have an application usage level. The level A1 means you have it in a safety relevant system and automated decision. You have it in such a system, but it's not decision-making. For instance, the diagnostic part does no, let's say, interfere with the control system. Then AI techniques using development, for the developer, that means somehow an offline support tool. You may know that in 26262 and 65508, you have always this for the support tools as well requirements. Yeah, that's the same here. That's the usage level B, and you can have it for decision making in this tool and not decision making. That means black box. Then usage level C, that is not part of the safety function, but could have indirect impact. For instance, the demand rate or the safety systems could be increased, or it reacts in a manner that, for instance, a driver in an automated driving system should take over, and that was a wrong message. And it, there is that this is already usage level C, and usage level D, it is not part of a critical controls, for instance, and behavior control of the system. That is a in this case. That was the original level here. There was usage level C partial allowed already under if you set up sufficient additional mitigation methods. But this was changed in the last version. I've shown in the last time the first version. Nothing is now recommended of class 3, the highest class, yeah, and until usage level D. And for the class 2, you have this appropriate set of requirements. The interesting issue is that in pass 8800, which with safety in the eye in automotive, they do not look at except this class 3 issue here. They always look at that everything that is allowed is class 2. It was really interesting approach here. So this recommended anyway, but this joint report should be considered, yeah, by all other standards which discuss somehow the usage of AI components, models and subsystems in safety related contexts. This document has a lot of interesting parts. It's a very many, many pages. Yeah, they look at the risk factors, verification, validation, yeah, on risk mitigation proposals, yeah, data preparation, model level validation, etc. And considering even the virtual testing, they have a subchapter on virtual testing on here concerning this. And of course, what is really important is monitoring and incident feedback. If you look at the automated driving standards of all groups where I'm working, yeah, they have the deployment phase and then they have the operations phase as well to look at and to always to have some feedback, because it will that no one expects that it will cover all requirements of any, let's say, usage level and any use environment where your automated vehicle is running. So they need an incident feedback and monitoring. That means explainable eye here is somehow a gray box approach. Huh? So, okay, that's the classification scheme that is always in this document. Yeah, you try to identify this usage level, which is described. Yeah, and then depending on what you are doing, you can say, okay, allowed, not allowed, and not recommended. So this is a workflow, how to work on that.
Okay, if you have 5 minutes to go, is it fine for you?
What?
On the timing 50
minutes, 500 minutes.
Yeah.
I will try. Okay.
Okay.
You have a 3-stage of realization: data acquisition, the knowledge induction, and the processing stage of outputs. Here they have a lot of details here and in the smart manufacturing standards as well. Yeah. Then you have made a list of properties and related risk factors. You can look at it, you will get all the slides. And they are taken from the working documents from the last few months. So it is really rather up to date, at least, maybe not from yesterday, but from the last weeks and months. Yeah. Now, automated driving systems. This is the picture I like most. Because it connects all these different AI and uncertainties inclusion in automotive standards. You see the basic standard 2602, you see 2144 SOTIF and PASS 8800 and the automated driving standards. The technical report does exist already, that was published some time ago, and the new TS is now is now worked on in many, many subgroups. Yeah, and this is very important because it has to connect with FAS 8800 with the AI ISO definitions and with this function safety in the, on the left side, sector dependent safety framework. Also, and that's really the tried really, that was my complaint at the beginning to them, the right tried really to say, okay, the regular AI and safety issues, the simple ones, are all in PAS 8800, and 50883 has this in the subgroup 6 on an IML, they're writing an NX, yeah? Just focus on the automated driving, so the automated driving and full autonomous cars problems, and not on the regular usage of AI in any other element of a vehicle. So they really wanted to separate that. Braunhofer and Munich is, for instance, very strong in this 8800 because I'm in this group and all this. Then you have, of course, additional for 26262, you have some additional with predictive maintenance issues where they want to use AI as well, yeah, and the pre-existing software issues, which and AI models may come in and our vehicle as pre-existing software, etc. And validation, verification is an overarching problem, which have now made even an additional task force and on harmonization of the different subgroups. Yeah? And that is a rate issue where people of us and Austria, like you, Martin, are working on. These are the subgroups of these automated driving systems. The most important issues are safety strategy, validation, verification capabilities, and for particular post-deployment safety. That's different from the regular functional safety standards. You have a set of requirements and you have to look to fulfill them. Here, you have always a feedback loop which might even update the safety requirements. That is one part which we introduced. I was in this group and when I said that should be done, and it was in the SafeTrans recommendations as well. You have always to have this feedback, the post-deployment safety, which is very, very important. Then cybersecurity as well. You have mentioned already that cybersecurity, no safety without cybersecurity, you have always to look at both. That is a very old story. I had my first paper that 20 years ago, but nobody was interested at this time. Now it's now a real regular issue everywhere. Then we have the interaction with the other standards. I mentioned this PAS 8833 is for safety of in road vehicles, but and therefore the others, 58.3, should focus on the autonomous driving functions. Here there are some in the annex. I have taken some of these examples on machine learning applications, etc. Yeah, so you can look how which machine technologies and what for specific requirements you should, let's say, set up. It is, of course, the requirement specification is a key issue, which might be, let's say, a circular activity as well. You see here some examples. I will not talk about that. And this PAS 8833 safety and AI is another working group, parallel, and that started a little bit late. That's 1583. Yeah, you see here they have started in 9 subteams, and I am some of them. Also, it's incredible at the moment, because many of these meetings are in parallel on the same day, etc., etc., and weekly. So it's enormous what is doing here. What I'm mainly interested in is, again, this doing operation and continuous assurance. This issue is my hobby, so to say, and therefore I marked it here yellow. That is really different from all of the conventional safety standards. Yeah. On the bottom, you see, there's a comment that the annex is considered for methods and tools, but it's not at the moment. Yeah. So we have a project, ARDEX and teaching, which looks at particular methods for validation, verification, and the inclusion of human in the loop. Yeah. And these are so advanced at the moment that we cannot include it because that is not taken as a topic in this paths and standards. Yeah. And again, we have also guidelines application for semiconductors in 26262, which are updated. And in the 658-2-1 is a new work item just starting, requirements for complex semiconductors. And this is, of course, an issue where AI components are important as well. Then we have these type approval issues with the so-called minimum risk position and the positive balance of risks. And these two issues are really very difficult because particularly positive risk balance of risks to calculate in advance, and the proof will be after years of deployment, that is really a problem. And even some standards try to avoid to discuss this, but this positive balance of risk is one of the most important issues for homologation and allowance to go to the street. Yeah. Here are the ethical aspects. Compared with my last presentation, there are some additional new documents like the UNESCO recommendations on ethics, which include particular the obligations that everyone who applies AI should make an assessment of the ethical impact before it is allowed to apply. And this guidance for this V&V issue, according to ethical principles, is that you have particular look at the vulnerable road users. Yeah. Then one thing I want to mention, which is really just new, because this regulation for type approval of the ADS was published in August last year, and it covers fully automated vehicles, yeah, in predefined areas for goods and passengers, hub to hub. That means fully automated vehicles on a predefined route with fixed start and endpoints, and automated valid parking, which we know that exists already. And these regulations, yeah, are very clear and very extensive. I have one slide or two just to show what they are doing. And by July 24, they want to update this to make it for the fully automated vehicles, which is not covered. It's just covered these particular cases here. And the TS-58-3, this automated driving systems specification, also the working draft, was also presented to the UNECE, that is the regulatory authority for road traffic in Europe. Yeah? That is very important. And this is available from the tech, this work is available from the web as well. It's free. Yeah, you can read it. And this compliance assessments, they have a real, there are several parts, scenarios you have to consider. The assessment of the safety concept, the test for most relevant traffic scenarios, and the principles to be used for this credibility assessment. For instance, if you are using a virtual tool chain simulations and so on. And that is, they have in the part one, a minimum set of traffic scenarios defined. And you'll see these pictures. There's even a typo in this official publication. It's A and B, of course, these two examples here, of distances during left turning and right turning. So that is the key issues, which you are looking also in the ARTEX project. So that is one of the key issues, not only lane change parameters, but also the left and right turning, which are most critical in traffic. Yeah? And they have defined here what to look at. Yeah. And this is here a list of the behavior competences for such events. You see on the left side the events, yeah, vehicle decelerating, vehicle weather, opposite vehicle encroaching, and what should be the response by an automated system, which yet has to be tested. Yeah. And what was really the interesting issue is that that this document describes very well, yeah, in the detail, the same scenarios. And if you, what is done in this working drafts and published standards of automated driving already. So they really have the same, let's say, mental source, I would say. So you can find all of these provisions and ideas which are in these dozen documents already on automated and highly automated systems, yeah, in this first European regulation. That is very interesting. This regulation you can download as well yourself. Yeah. And then smart manufacturing, I just want to point out that there's one part six, evaluation of intelligence properties for smart manufacturing. And that is a picture which they had. And one of them is artificial intelligence, perception, monitoring, so several things which could be with the exception of predictive sensoring. So you done mainly by classical methods, and by artificial intelligence, of course, come in all these problems you have in general in artificial intelligence. And then you have on the top of the artificial intelligence on the right, on the top, intelligent like humans. I wondered what they mean and what was the answer in this document. It is not handled in this document. As I was really laughed that you set up a property which you cannot even define reasonably. Okay. And these are these properties in the assessment. That means even smart manufacturing, there's a separate part for these AI applications. And the intelligence levels are defined and so on with some requirements and definitions here. And that's it. That are my acknowledgements, because all of these European projects have to do with standards and AI nowadays, and they are funding my work as a freelancer. Okay, thanks.
Erwin, thank you very much for this extensive insights of standardization, what's going on.